Welcome to Duke Chapel for this service of Choral Evensong according to the 1662 Book of Common Prayer. A particular welcome to members of the choir of Christ Church Episcopal Church in Raleigh. Today the Anglican Communion keeps the commemoration of the Oxford martyrs Latimer, Ridley, and Cranmer. Thomas Cranmer was largely responsible for putting together the Anglican Book of Common Prayer from which this evening's service is taken. Dearly beloved, the scripture moveth us in sundry places to acknowledge and confess our manifold sins and wickedness, and that we should not dissemble nor cloak them before the face of Almighty God, our Heavenly Father, but confess them with an humble, lowly, penitent, and obedient heart, to the end that we may obtain forgiveness of the same by His infinite goodness and mercy. And although we ought at all times humbly to acknowledge our sins before God, yet ought we chiefly so to do when we assemble and meet together to render thanks for the great benefits that we have received at His hands, to set forth His most worthy praise, to hear His most holy word, and to ask those things which are requisite and necessary, as well for the body as the soul. Wherefore, I pray and beseech you, as many as are here present, to accompany me with a pure heart and a humble voice unto the throne of the heavenly grace, saying, Almighty and most merciful Father, we have erred and strayed from thy ways like lost sheep. We have followed too much the devices and desires of our own hearts. We have left against thy holy laws. We have left undone those things which we ought to have done, and we have done those things which we ought not to have done. And there is no health in us. But thou, O Lord, have mercy upon us, miserable offenders. Spare thou them which confess their faults. Restore thou them that are penitent, according to thy promises declared unto mankind in Christ Jesus our Lord. And grant, O most merciful Father, for his sake, that we may hereafter live a godly, righteous, and sober life, to the glory of thy holy name. Amen. Almighty God, the Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who desireth not the death of a sinner, but rather that he may turn from his wickedness and live, hath given power and commandment to his ministers to declare and pronounce to his people, being penitent, the absolution and remission of their sins. He pardoneth and absolveth all those who truly repent and unfeignedly believe his holy gospel. Wherefore, let us beseech him to grant us true repentance and his Holy Spirit, that those things may please him which we do at this present, and that the rest of our life hereafter may be pure and holy, so that at the last we may come to his eternal joy, through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, for ever and ever. Amen.
O Lord, open thy ears.
Please be seated for the psalm appointed for today, Psalm 114, verses 1 to 8.
The Old Testament lesson is from the book of Jonah, the 3rd and 4th chapters. The word of the Lord came to Jonah a second time, saying, "Get up, go to Nineveh, that great city, and proclaim to it the message that I tell you." So Jonah set out and went to Nineveh, according to the word of the Lord. Now Nineveh was an exceedingly large city, a 3 days' walk across. Jonah began to go into the city, going a day's walk. And he cried out, 40 days more, and Nineveh shall be overthrown." And the people of Nineveh believed God. They proclaimed a fast, and everyone, great and small, put on sackcloth. When the news reached the king of Nineveh, he rose from his throne, removed his robe, covered himself with sackcloth, and sat in ashes. Then he had a proclamation made in Nineveh. "By the decree of the king and his nobles, no human being or animal, no herd or flock, shall taste anything. They shall not feed, nor shall they drink water. Human beings and animals shall be covered with sackcloth, and they shall cry mightily to God. All shall turn from their evil ways and from the violence that is in their hands. Who knows? God may relent and change his mind. He may turn from his fierce anger so that we do not perish." When God saw what they did, how they turned from their evil ways, God changed his mind about the calamity that he had said he would bring upon them, and he did not do it. But this was very displeasing to Jonah, and he became angry. He prayed to the Lord and said, O Lord, is not this what I said while I was still in my own country? That is why I fled to Tarshish at the beginning, for I knew that you are a gracious God and merciful, slow to anger and abounding in steadfast love, and ready to relent from punishing. And now, O Lord, please take my life from me, for it is better for me to die than to live. And the Lord said, Is it right for you to be angry? Then Jonah went out of the city and sat down east of the city and made a booth for himself there. He sat under it in the shade, waiting to see what would become of the city. The Lord God appointed a bush and made it come up over Jonah to give shade over his head, to save him from his discomfort. So Jonah was very happy about the bush. But when dawn came up the next day, God appointed a worm that attacked the bush so that it withered. When the sun rose, God prepared a sultry east wind, and the sun beat down on the head of Jonah so that he was faint and asked that he might die. He said, It is better for me to die than to live. But God said to Jonah, Is it right for you to be angry about the bush? And he said, Yes, angry enough to die. Then the Lord said, You are concerned about the bush, for which you did not labor and for which you did not grow. It came into being in a night and perished in a night. And should I not be concerned about Nineveh, that great city, in which there are more than 120,000 people who do not know their right hand from their left, and also many animals? This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
Thank you.
The New Testament lesson is from the book of Acts, the 27th chapter. When the 14th night had come, as we were drifting across the Sea of Adria, about midnight, the sailors suspected that they were nearing land. So they took soundings and found 20 fathoms. A little farther on, they took soundings again and found 15 fathoms. Fearing that we might run on the rocks, they let down 4 anchors from the stern and prayed for day to come. But when the sailors tried to escape from the ship and had lowered the boat into the sea, on the pretext of putting out anchors from the bow, Paul said to the centurion and the soldiers, "Unless these men stay in the ship, you cannot be saved." Then the soldiers cut away the ropes of the boat and set it adrift. Just before daybreak, Paul urged all of them to take some food, saying, "Today is the 14th day that you have been in suspense and remaining without food, having eaten nothing. Therefore, I urge you to take some food, for it will help you survive. For none of you will lose a hair from your heads." After he had said this, he took bread, and giving thanks to God in the presence of all, he broke it and began to eat. Then all of them were encouraged and took food for themselves. We were in all 276 persons in the ship. After they had satisfied their hunger, they lightened the ship by throwing the wheat into the sea. In the morning, they did not recognize the land, but they noticed a bay with a beach on which they planned to run the ship ashore if they could. So they cast off the anchors and left them in the sea. At the same time, they loosened the ropes that tied the steering oars. Then, hoisting the foresail to the wind, they made for the beach. But, striking a reef, they ran the ship aground. The bow stuck and remained immovable, but the stern was being broken up by the force of the waves. The soldiers' plan was to kill the prisoners so that none might swim away and escape. But the centurion, wishing to save Paul, kept them from carrying out their plan. He ordered those who could swim to jump overboard first and make for land, and the rest to follow, some on planks and others on pieces of the ship. And so it was that all were brought safely to land. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God.
I believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen.
Let us pray. Lord,
is a setting by Henry Balfour Gardner of the ancient hymn used at the office of Compline. Te lucis ante terminum, to thee, O Lord, at close of day.
Thank you. Living God, you speak your words to all of your true prophets. Your words break into our worlds, redirecting our lives back to you. Lord, reorient our lives to your living word, your Son, that we may witness to your life wherever we are. Draw near to our cities and communities throughout your world, where acts of violence are spoken and performed. In these places, call your people to repent, putting on sackcloth and grieving our divisions. We ask you to equip us to choose life. Forgive us of our arrogance when we choose our life instead of yours, that you have poured out for us. Lord, give us the eyes to learn from the humility of others. Transform us to see the world through the lens of the cross, and shape us to see beauty, intellect, and power through Christ's broken and resurrected body. Lord, when we become angry with you, this world, and each other, sit with us, speak to us, hear our words that we speak, and use that anger to guide us into places of brokenness to help create your way, truth, and life here on earth. Lord of the sea and storm, nothing in this world can escape your glory. Amidst the storms of this life, you call out, welcoming us onto the shore. Lord, be with any who feel as if they're engulfed by a storm at sea. In this month, we remember all who have stories to share of domestic, dating, and gender violence. Be with any who still carry the heaviness of that violence and trauma. Help us, your church, to be a safe space of welcome, conversation, and courage. Move us to join the dialogue to change our culture on campuses and in our society where disrespect and violence are accepted. As we navigate the waters of our society, culture, and politics this election season, guide us to care and engage one another, our community, in the way of Christ. Lord, walk among communities throughout the world that live in fear of violence, abduction, and war. And may your story of love, peace, and reconciliation conquer all, through us or even in spite of us. God of the fall and autumn, as we witness colder temperatures and falling leaves, and notice the coming of winter in the world around us, help us to die to ourselves, so we may bear the fruit of abundance of new life in you. Lord, go with us into the night. We pray all of this in the name of Jesus, who walks among us. Amen. May the strength of God guide you. May the wisdom of God instruct you. May the hand of God protect you. May the word of God direct you this day and every day. Go now in peace. In the blessing of God Almighty, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, be among you and remain with you always. Amen.